onset friendships. Like, I think it's really cool that you guys all get to come together at, like, conventions, because I've heard filmmaking is sort of like summer camp, so this is almost like summer camp reunions for you guys.
Wow. It's so hard to get a job as an actor, and then when you got a movie that you know is going to do well. And so we had these little meetings at Rennie Harlan's house, and we'd all hang out, and it kind of helped when we actually got on the set and started working together. And then I always explain it like this, because we're the only ones that were in the movie, so we kind of experienced a kind of a really unique thing, like astronauts or something. You know, we're in this thing, this Nightmare on Elm Street train, and we're all in it together, so we have a friendship because we're the ones that are actually in it. You know, I compare it to like being in a kick-ass band, and you guys were famous back sometime, and you guys people know you. Like, yeah, that dude was a drummer, that guy was that guy, yeah, no one knows you. It's kind of so. I always tell people that we're pop culture icons.
I think what this is a surprise as well, and what's amazing is that the casting is like Nightmare 4, we are all genuinely friends. I mean, we see each other, most of us live in Los Angeles, and we see each other on a regular basis. Amanda Wiss and I have become really good friends. You know, we see each other like every week, talk every week. Tuesday night, she and I had a business, Toe Rights, for a number of years.
Successful business.
Kelly Jo and I, we hang out. Toy Newkirk, she lived with me for about a year when she decided to transplant from New York back to Los Angeles. Brooke Thies, her son and my youngest son were the same age. We'd go bowling together and hang out. So it's amazing the chemistry that you see on screen. It's so real. And it has now gone into almost 30 years of friendships. I mean, like, what I say is if one of them needed a kidney, I would give them one. Okay? So that's, you know, how we feel. We really do love
each
other.
It's a unique bond. It's really fun.
It is unique.
It did start when we made the movie. It really did. It started then. We all got along. No one was difficult. And everyone was rooting for each other. They wanted, you know, we wanted...
Well, you were a little difficult. You just didn't know. I
was an asshole. Probably was. I don't remember.
How about for you guys? Do you have any sort of recollections of being able to hang out with everybody on set, or?
Well, I guess Lisa doesn't want to hang out with me. That's kind of weird. Yeah.
We were in a different movie. We didn't work together.
We still see each other all the time and love each other. I'm giving her a hard time. It is like that. And then there's some films that I've done. Like, you know, I've been really blessed to have two iconic things going on: Back to the Future 2 and 3, which is a huge iconic film, and this Nightmare experience. So, but sometimes you get on the set, and it's like you said, everyone's really close, and then it's over.
You never see each other again, right?
You never see each other again.
But this is
different. This, and also same with Back to the Future for me. I'm still really good friends with Jason Scott Lee, Darlene Vogel, and our great friends. I did a short, and she was in it with me with the money. So yeah, it's a beautiful thing. I really enjoy it myself, so I think you're right about that, Danny.
But I mean, now all I can think about is like a reality show that follows Nightmare cast members as they hang out in Los Angeles. So if I had money, I would give you guys to make that show, because I'd watch that. We're going to go ahead and open it up to audience questions in a minute. So if anybody has some questions, I mean, we've got an amazing array of folks up here, so I'm sure there's got to be some questions, so feel free to line up. We have no mic on this side, so if you can come to that side, that would be super. I don't know my left and my right up here anymore, but it's that side of the room. But my one last question would be for you guys. What is your favorite Robert Englund memory? Like, do you have one? I mean, I know you've worked, you know, a couple of you guys got to do a couple movies with him, but I'm just curious, you know, if it doesn't even have to be a Freddy memory, but I just know he's a guy that you can sit and have a conversation for 2 hours and not even talk about anything related to Nightmare on Elm Street, and it's the most amazing conversation you'll
he's
ever have in
talker.
Your life.
Right? Is he a fun talker? I said you can talk the balls off a rhinoceros. And he's so fun to listen to. You're just like, yeah.
He is quite the raconteur, absolutely.
He knows everybody ever was in Hollywood, personally.
I have a sort of funny memory. We were in the makeup trailer, and he's getting his, you know, face on, you know. Not a pretty face, you know. Women say, I'm putting my face on. Well, never mind, that joke didn't work. But anyway, he's getting his face on, and we're chatting, and, you know, it's just like any other day. Oh, this is what we do. We put, you know, he's getting prosthetics on and stuff. and he was talking about remodeling his bathroom, and we were talking about interior design, and he was trying to figure out what grout color to use in the tile. As you know, prosthetics are being placed on his face, and Howard's telling him, stop talking, Robert, for a minute, I need to paint this part of your face. So it was just sort of very surreal, you know? Anyway, that's a funny memory I have.
What color did he choose for the grout, do you remember?
I'm really curious, actually. I think green.
We were shooting at Venice High, and I think at the time there was an elementary school, so there was no high school kids, it was all our extras, we kind of took over the high school. But there was an elementary school from like third grade down to like kindergarten, and Robert was there that day, he was in makeup, and people had heard, oh, Freddy Krueger movie, oh, there's a Nightmare on Elm Street. So these little kids come out of their like recess or whatever, and they were holding onto the fence, and they're shaking it, and they're like, Freddy, and they're all these little kids, they couldn't control them, they wanted to see him so bad, and they're little kids. So, Robert is full makeup, he comes out, hat on, greasy skin, teeth in, he's just like, these kids shit themselves. I see them, they're running around trying to grab him, you know, they're like, oh my god, he looks so, I laughed so hard, I was like, that was awesome. That was my, yeah, he was Robert's fun, man.
I didn't have very much interaction with Robert during the filming because Stephen wanted it to be a real kind of reaction when we were in the Hershey chocolate swimming
pool. Oh, yeah.
So I didn't really have that much interaction with him until I did my scenes. But the man is a wonderful man. He's always trying to help people. He is like a film historian, encyclopedia, you know what I mean? And he's always willing to help somebody. Or help somebody's career, or he's an enigma in Hollywood for sure because people are about themselves. So I feel blessed to, you know, have worked with the man and these people for sure.
Yeah, when we were doing our film, Robert and I were the only ones really in doing the makeup, so we would be the first ones on the set getting the trailer and be putting the makeup stuff on, doing his and my. And it was like strange for me because he would be Robert and he'd be talking to me and then he would be Freddie and be talking to me. But I'm looking at him and he's Freddie and he's talking like Robert, and it was just like the strangest like morphation thing. And then we would have to, at the end of the film, we would always be the last ones in the trailer getting the makeup off too, because it takes 3 hours to get it off and 3 hours to get it on. And it was quite the thing, but I'll never forget sitting there and having these conversations with him. And like you guys said, he's one of the smartest guys I know. I've learned so much, not only about being an actor, but how to treat and be with the people that love you, and not be one of those actors that, you know, come to the table and push you away and give you 2 seconds of their time. I've learned a lot from the man. He's super smart. He's a foodie. There's nothing he doesn't know about. Yeah, we sit afterwards and just hear conversation after conversation of this guy, and I just sit there like a kid, go, what, really? Yeah, he's great. So I think that was it for me, just that, like I said, that transformation of in the makeup, Freddie, but he's talking like Robert. Yeah, Ricky, remember when I was like, you know, I'm just looking at him like I'm trying to listen to you, dude. But
any crowd conversations?
I can't think, but yeah, that was it for me.
Yeah, definitely. The first moment I met him, he wanted to help me, right? And the next thing I know, I'm trapped on a bus with him, driving through the desert. And then we're in a mechanical bus, and he did the same thing, you know, like after you, and then talking about whatever it is that you were into, and then he had five different 10 things to say. Right.
He's a good guy.
All right. Well, we have a line over here, so we're going to start with you, sir. Go right ahead.
Hi. Just wanted to say that I think Dream Master is maybe my favorite Elm Street movie, and you know, as far as just you know, it holds up, and like watching it, you know again and again and everything. I mean, it's really a good movie, and I don't think that really would work without you know, Lisa, Danny, and the rest of you guys. Like you know, if you don't have like good performances for people that you kind of invest in, you know, it really doesn't work. So just want to say I enjoyed the movie very much. And Danny, I'm a little disappointed you don't have the blow-dried kind of bouffant hair.
You know what? I think the next con I'm just going to come dressed as the character. Block the hair.
You still got hair.
Right,
I wondered if you and Brooke had like a contest for poofy hair or something.
Yes.
That movie
was the
80s. Glorious 80s.
Right, no, that was conservative.
It was the 80s, right?
Flock of Seagulls looking thing. George
he was
Michael.
Hot. You were hot.
I was good looking.
You're still good looking.
What is it, one hunky guy? And you are I did have a question for Lisa. Did you feel like you were cast against type, or that was kind of your type for Alex?
I was cast against type because I didn't even get an audition because back then, I mean, do you guys remember Barbizon Modeling School? Okay, all right. I had gone to Barbizon Model. I was a tomboy, honestly, but. So I had the 80s makeup, the 80s, I naturally, like platinum blonde hair, and my headshot, I mean, did not look like what they had in mind for Alice, not one bit. And Annette Benson, who cast most of the Nightmare movies, she tells me this story that they went through over 600 actresses auditioning them for the role of Alice. They could not find their Alice. They couldn't find her. So they went to the reject pile.
They called me in to read with you and another girl. I don't know who she is. But there was another Alice.
Yeah,
but
it was down to two. Yeah. And then I went in, and I went in with dirty hair, wore my worst color, no makeup. Because, I mean, I went to UCLA, a theater major. I thought it was called acting, you know, this thing. And I got the role. So,
but
yeah.
It was awesome, because your character has the wicked character art.
She is.
Oh, it's great. Yeah. It's a dream role for a performer. It's a dream role to have that character arc, yeah. But I never get recognized because I don't have the red hair.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Next.
Hi. You guys already mentioned how relatable a lot of the characters are. Especially being, you know, a kid who grew up during that time with a lot of the parent issues that the characters had, you know, like Alice having an alcoholic father. Did you think about when you played these roles what an impact that you would have on kids, or especially being Alice, you know, coming from this mousy, nerdy girl to being this badass chick, that you would not only affect women, but little gay boys from the Midwest.
Wow, I'm gonna cry. During the film, I didn't think of the impact. I really didn't. I worked on my role and I just did the best I could. And I honestly didn't realize, I didn't think about the impact it would have until years later, you know? So, but thank you, and I have a lot of people tell me stories, you know. But also, I am that Alice character in grade school, daydreamer, wallflower, read books. I didn't, you know, we moved a lot, and I just kept to myself, and I, you know, so I definitely could relate to the character, but I'm so thrilled that the impact. And also Nightmare 5, too, all of the social issues that were dealt with, bulimia, teen pregnancy, teenagers' rights, drunk driving, like so many brave topics, and think in 1989 for 5 those topics. So anyway, thank you. I'm glad it had some influence.
No, thank you.
Right on.
All right, we have time for one quick question. Make it awesome. No pressure.
Wow. It's not really a question, just another comment. Just kind of like you guys were saying, thank you to the fans. I think everyone here thanks you guys for, like you said, taking time and not just pushing us aside, because so many actors today and with the media and stuff, we just see how they don't appreciate things, and we're really appreciative of that. And also horror fans, I think you're right, we're a lot of people grew up loving them because we had not maybe Freddy in our nightmares, but we had things we were running from. So really thank you for just keep coming and, you know, spending your time with us. So it's more of a thank you guys for thank
you. You're welcome. Awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Panel, but don't forget tonight, Dreammaster, big screen outside. Woo! Gonna have a big Q&A before that, and let's give it up for Lisa Wilcox.